jumping up and down the floor. My hat is an animal.
Hi, can you introduce yourself, please?
Hi, I'm Lillian Lennon. I'm the current president of RSVP, Inc., Animal Welfare and Rescue. I've been a volunteer for RSVP since 2011, but I've supported RSVP since its inception in 1996.
My name is Sue Hansen. I'm a volunteer with RSVP, Inc., and my role is primarily as grant writer, and I'm also instrumental in their website. And I try to assist the president and the other volunteers whenever there's a need.
Hi, my name is Kelly Keenan. I'm the Community Outreach Coordinator for RSVP Animal Rescue.
RSVP started out as the Riverhead Shelter Volunteer Program, where four women began supplementing care and supporting the animals, specifically dogs, at the Riverhead Shelter by helping the staff create a better environment for the dogs at the shelter. It eventually branched out into an outreach program into the communities where spay, neuter, and vet care, and supplying food and dog houses and supplies for the local communities that needed them to care for their animals.
Can you tell us a little bit about how the group was founded?
RSVP was founded in 1996. There was a small group of ladies that volunteered at the Riverhead Animal Shelter, and they were very helpful in providing the dogs with exercise and socialization and promoting them for adoption.
Can you tell us a little bit about what the mission of RSVP is today?
We have two major missions. The short-term mission is going into the local communities, specifically impoverished communities, to supplement care and help people hold on to their animals and keep them out of the shelters whenever possible. When that's not possible, we try to find alternative ways to find animals' homes through foster care and also adopting them out, obviously, when we can. The long-term goals are mainly twofold. One is political action. We try to make sure our current laws are humane and up to date with the needs of the animals that we care for. And humane education, educating the youth and the new generations so they can properly understand what it takes to own and care for an animal.
Well, the group recognized that the real problem with overpopulation in the shelter stemmed from the communities. There were dogs that were not fixed. They weren't spayed or neutered. They were producing litters of puppies. There weren't enough homes for these animals, and a lot of them wound up at the shelter. So they began a very critical program. It's referred to as our outreach program, where they would actually go out into the community and offer assistance to those needing it most, and particularly people who wouldn't necessarily come and ask for assistance. They provided veterinary care, spay-neuter services, which was very critical, and also just generally promoting responsible pet ownership, and that's how the name evolved into Responsible Solutions for Valued Pets.
Can you tell us why your outreach program is so important?
Our outreach program is so important because we are out in the community. We're out where the animals are. We're making a difference where the animals are. They're not in a shelter. They're in their communities and they're in their homes outside. And we're trying to change the situation by educating some of the owners. One time I went up to a house and I was walking to the back, and there was the children always come up when I'm there because I give out snacks to the dogs. So a lot of the kids like to give snacks to the dogs. They'll run in the back with me. And I said to a little boy, "Do you have a dog?" And he said, "No, I have a backyard dog." And I said, "What's a backyard dog?" He goes, "That's a dog that just sits out there in the backyard." So it's all about changing the way the cycle goes so that one day the pets that are outside become part of a family inside.
This property, we've taken off quite a few dogs. Some of them died. Some of them were in horrific condition. Again, it was an animal cruelty case. Someone was arrested, but the rest of the dogs stayed. That's just how it is. We have a house around the corner that was charged with the first animal cruelty case here. It was horrendous. He had a padlock. It was 20 degrees out. He had no doghouse. He had a huge tow chain on him. We wouldn't leave. We brought the SPCA came there. The police arrested. The dog still stayed. The guy agreed to let us help with the dog. So we came. We brought him. He wouldn't allow a pen in the yard, and it's illegal to leave your dog out. So on a chain. So the next thing we knew, within 2 months later, the dog, he said, died overnight for some reason. A year later, and that I hadn't been on that property to help those dogs, a dog starved to death. The dogs were all on chains. We got another group and the SPCA to come in. We put in big pens for these dogs for the first time in their lives. We took off the dogs that were sick and dying. Some were able to go into homes, and some of them were humanely euthanized. And only because they were so sick, they were dying on their own. There are over...
It's a colony.
Yeah, there are over 50 feral cats in this colony. There was a woman taking care of her family. She died. There were over 300 cats then. And believe it or not, they tore down the shelters for the cats, which was a trail the woman lived in. Cats scattered. There's about 50 to 60 cats there now. We go there a few times a week, and we feed. They get some food from the shelter, the guy who lives there, her ex-husband. But he is not, can't really care for the cats really well. There's so many. So we put up a bunch of shelters for them. There's a lot of sick cats there. We're trying to do vetting, but it's very expensive. We are doing them one cat at a time. We've got about 8 cats out of there, which is nothing compared to the amount that are there. But one at a time is all we could really do. So we go there and we feed. We're meeting one of the cat girls there. I get a lot of my food from the local restaurants that are going to throw out. I cook my own dog food, and I give the cat girl a lot of the fish that he gives me, and she cooks it up. We put it on the, to save money on cat food, we put it with the cat food. And I do 2 to 3 times a week, I cook up all the food that I get from the restaurant, melt it down. I have a 22-quart crock pot, and I cook it for days and make it like into pot roast and melt apart. And then I mix layer by layer, dry food, wet food, with this food, with the gravy, with the meat that I get from the farm country. And I end up saving a lot of money for our group. We don't have to buy canned food as much to feed, and I can give it out to all the families that need it, because we have to have food for the dogs 7 days a week, because a lot of the dogs are not fed every day.
So community outreach program is different from any other community programs that have been around. We were the first group to actually go into the communities to try and change the environments that the dogs were living in. We go into mostly the impoverished areas, the drug-laden areas, the areas that a lot of the police officers will not go into, and they don't think we should go into, but those are the areas where most of the animals need help. We've fined the dogs most of the areas on chains, not fed properly. Their shelters are insufficient for the dogs. And what our group does is we actually go in and work with the people. We're non-judgmental to the people in the areas, and that's what gets us in. We don't judge people. We don't ask them to do anything for us. We show them that we are there for the animals. We're not judging how the people live. We're not judging what the people do. We're just trying to educate them on how to care for their animals and letting them know that we are. If they don't have the money, that's okay. We are going to help them. We're going to help their dog. We're going to show them, or their cats, and show them what needs to be done for the animal to have the proper care. And now that the laws have changed, when we first went into a lot of these areas, all the dogs were on chains. From everything from little Jack Russells to pugs to pit bulls to shepherds and rotties. The animals there was no laws to protect them against that. And our group has been instrumental in bringing up the new law where the animals cannot be tethered for more than an hour, or the people will be fined. And the SPCA has been fining people. So we tell them, we will help you so that the animals are in pens, and our group raises money and put pens up for these animals. We bring dog houses. We try and make it a sufficient way for the animal to live the best they can outside.
A lot of the local restaurants I go to, and they will give me the scraps that they have, the leftover meat, and I cook it, and I make dog food, and I bring that out to feed our outreach dogs, which saves our group a lot of money because we get the donations from the restaurants.
How many dogs are you feeding on a weekly basis?
35 to 50 dogs, depending on which dogs are still there. We go out 2 to 3 times every single week. One of the biggest challenges we face is the cultural difference of the way dogs are cared for. In our society, we believe that animals are part of our family, pets that are kept inside. Unfortunately, where we usually see the dogs culturally, the dogs are kept outside. That's how they were raised, with their dogs outside and cared for as property, as watchdogs. They are not part of the family. And that's one of the biggest obstacles we face, is trying to show them that they actually have feelings, that they're dogs that need to be taken care of, that there's certain care that has to be provided to an animal, and hopefully someday that they realize that they should be pets inside their home and part of the family. And that's why we do educational programs, so that we could stop this cycle of realizing that the animals should be pets and not property.
Could you introduce yourself, please?
Hi, I'm Ray Bozzello, treasurer and trainer for RSVP. I've been with the group now for about 15 years. And what I basically do here is the dogs that come out of the hoods that are surrendered to us come here for rehabilitation, so we can get them adopted and into families, into good family homes.
Can you give us a little bit of an idea of what it takes to get a dog that's been surrendered through the process to being able to be adopted?
Yeah, sure. It's just like, dogs are just like people. Every dog has a personality. They'll vary. And first thing we do is, when we get a dog out of the yard, out of the hood, we bring him here. And the first couple weeks, I have very little interaction with the dog. We just get to know each other. We feel each other out. Usually these dogs had a horrific upbringing, and they have a lot of issues that have to be dealt with. So it takes time just to feel each other out and get comfortable with each other. So there's a couple weeks in doing that. And then once we feel like we're getting comfortable with each other, then I start to do the basic training, which happens every morning. We get up early and every dog goes out for 45 minutes and we do basic training. And that's just to teach them to stay, sit, and to get some focus out of these dogs, so they can start being in the real world. As of the point I get them, the only thing they've ever known was a chain and a backyard. Every dog's an individual. So some dogs, I can get them to flip rather quickly, and some dogs, they may take. I've had dogs here a couple years before I could get them out of here.
Who's this guy here?
Okay, this here is Kiwi. Kiwi is about 7 or 8 years old. He was at the North Fork shelter, and they were having some issues with him. So they asked if I had a dog that I could trade out, an adoptable dog to trade out and work with this guy. So I did. I gave them a dog and we traded out, and I got Kiwi. And there's like 5 stages in the whole process. Kiwi would probably be around stage 3. He's playing with other dogs now, which is a big, big plus for him. It needs to be supervised, but he's playing with other dogs. He has his good moments, and he has the ability to be a good boy. We just gotta find the key and get it unlocked. Benny's in his final training stages. He's in the house with me now, and he's come a long way. Benny was very afraid. Come here, Benny.
Come here, baby.
Come here, baby. Come here. Benny was a very fearful dog, and to get him to be not fearful took a bit, but he's starting to come around now. He's been with me a couple years, and he's very dog friendly. He loves dogs, which is unusual for a fearful dog.
How did you come to start working with RSVP?
Actually, the way I got involved, one of my wife's friends, a nurse, and she was actually one of the founders of the group, Linda Mosca. And she I had a lot of dogs at that point. I had five of my own dogs, and I've always worked with dogs, and she knew that. So she asked me if I would give some time to the group to help them with the dogs that they had. So I agreed, and this is what it turned into. It turned into one of the best things I've ever done.
Good boy, good boy, good boy. Good boy, good boy, good boy.
We really take some extra care for the dogs that we have on outreach. We always make sure in the winter that the dogs have coats. We raise funds and we get coats for the dogs because they live outside. So one time I got a call in the car that the SPCA and the local shelter was trying to trap a dog that was running loose in Riverhead and they couldn't catch it, and it was really not, they were unable to get the dog, and they called me if I could help. And I asked, why would you call me to help? She says, because it's one of your dogs. And I said, how do you know it's one of RSVP's dogs? And they said, because there's a pit bull running around with a coat on. So I went to I told them I would come into Riverhead. I went there, and the dog knew me. So immediately when I went over to her, everybody put down their rabies poles, and I went up to her. I called her over, and I called China over, and she came to me, and she was just scared because she was out of her element, and she was a very good dog. And actually that dog, who spent 7 years on a chain outside, was surrendered to RSVP and is living now for 2 years in a home, and I see pictures of her all the time. She has a wonderful, wonderful home. The last picture we took, we posted up because it was a picture of her looking outside from the inside, and we put it up and said how she feels now being inside looking out instead of being outside always looking in.
Years ago, I would accompany another volunteer, Kelly, on outreach, and on this one occasion we visited the Puspatuck Reservation, and there are a lot of dogs in that area that are kept outdoors, and one in particular was a little Jack Russell Terrier. And he was only about 30 pounds and very thin skin, but he was being kept in an igloo, a little plastic igloo outside during the winter months, and the temperatures were freezing. And we knew that if we could convince the owners to surrender him, we still weren't sure that we could place him anyplace. We needed to find a home. And I decided that I would give it a try and foster him in my home. And he wound up becoming a permanent member of the family. And it was such a great feeling to be able to save a little dog like that, because it was just so sad to have an animal like that being kept outside in an igloo during the harsh winter months. It was just horrible. So that was an experience that I'll never forget.
How long did you have that dog?
I guess I had him about almost 10 years. As a matter of fact, he just passed away recently. He was a special little dog. His name was Yeo, and believe it or not, that's kind of the vernacular slang for cocaine. That was his name that he was given because he was a little white dog. But that just goes to show us the type of, you know, the kind of obstacles that we face in rescue, you know, the kind of heartbreaking stories that we encounter. It was very nice to be able to make a difference to that little dog's life.
Michelle here, this little girl, this sweet little girl, was one of our recent rescues. I was out in the community outreach van feeding on outreach, and I was flagged down by one of the community people asking for help. They said they had a dog in the back who had just had another litter of puppies. She had had originally 10 puppies, and somebody came by gunpoint, actually, and took 8 of the puppies, and there were 2 puppies left of Michelle. And she was very territorial at that point on a chain with the puppies, and she wouldn't let us near her or the puppies, and they said that somebody had left her there. And they didn't want to care for her. So we immediately worked with them and got them a dog house. She didn't have a dog house. So we got a dog house to her facility where she was living, to her home where she was living in the backyard. And we brought some food for the puppies and food for her and asked the people to just take care of her until we could figure out the next step, which we came back the next day and we're working with the people to get her spayed. So she wouldn't get pregnant again because the puppies were much older. They were probably 12 weeks old. So they let us take her, get her spayed, and we brought her back and worked on getting her surrendered. Michelle was surrendered to us, and she's been in foster care with us, and she's looking for a home. She is the most amazing, sweet, sweet dog. And after living her first approximately, I was heard, 4 years on a chain, now she's going to have a real life with us.
These guys don't do tricks. The trick with these guys is to get them to be adopted.